It is a pleasure for me to introduce Victor Pérez Abreu. We met more than 30 years ago when he was attending probability courses at our department. After that, we met frequently in conferences, in an international interinstitutional seminar on probability, which we had that lasted several years, and in my frequent visits to CIMAT, where he has been professor for 33 years. Now he's at the National Polytechnic Institute. He obtained a doctor's degree in statistics at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, United States. His leadership has been very important for probability in Mexico, especially at CIMAT, in particular for his organization of national and international meetings, supervision of doctoral students, and collaborations with several distinguished probability professors in other countries. Due to his contributions, he has been awarded distinctions, among them Fellow of the American Statistical Association, Fellow of the Institute of Mathematical Statistics, and he was elected president of the Bernoulli Society for Probability and Statistics, which is the most important international society in our field. He has also become an emeritus member of the National Center for Research in Mexico. I would like to mention that Victor and I have both worked on nuclear spaces, which is not probability, it's an area of topological vector spaces that has become very important in some areas in probability. We never worked together, but our interaction on the subject has been very important for me because of some things that I learned from him. The title of his talk is Eigenvalue Processes, an Overview. Go ahead, Victor.
Thank you very much, Luis, for the presentation. And thank you very much to the organizers of this probability session. And congratulations to the mathematics department of CIMVESTAC for his 60th anniversary. My talk will be an overview from my personal point of view of some results on the eigenvalue processes of random matrix processes. And I will try to cover all these points. I will recall some pioneering work on random matrices by Wigner and Marchenko-Pastour. And then I will explain the work by Dyson on what is called the Dyson-Brownian motion. And then I will present some extensions to fractional Brownian motion, matrix value Brownian motion. And at the end, I would like to say some words in Spanish about the math department of CIMVESTAC. So let's talk about the pioneering work of Eugene Wigner. So the motivation by Wigner to study random matrices comes from physics, from nuclear physics. And here we can see some levels of atoms at very high level of energies. And we can see that these high levels do not occur, do not happen very close, okay? Do not happen very close. And so let's recall what is called the Gaussian orthogonal ensemble, okay? It's a sequence of matrices, and each element of the sequence is an n by n matrix with random entries. That's simple ensemble of random matrices. And let's take the case of Gaussian entries independent in the upper triangular part, and independent also of the diagonal part, and we make it symmetric, okay? And for convenience, we assume that elements outside diagonal has normal distribution, standard one, and in the diagonal is zero mean, also normal distribution, and variance two, okay? And the distribution of Cn is orthogonal invariant under conjugations. That means that for each matrix, orthogonal matrix O, the distribution of O, Zn, O transpose, and Cn is the same. And this is a characterization of this GOE being independent entries and modulus this symmetry and orthogonal invariant. That's a characterization. That's a very nice property. Okay, so the joint density of the eigenvalues of such a random matrix for fixed n is as follows. If we take the eigenvalues of Cn, the joint density is of this type, a constant times this product of one-dimensional Gaussian densities with a variance two, plus this product of difference, okay? And this is the independence part of the joint density, and this shows a very strong dependence, okay? This is non-zero for J different of K, okay? And I have ordered the eigenvalues, okay? And this term is really the van der Moor determinant that comes from the Jacobian of the transformation from matrices to eigenvalues, okay? And it's not particular of Gaussian matrices, okay? This is in general. Whenever you have a matrix with a density and you want to make the change of variables from matrices to eigenvalues, this term will appear, van der Moor determinant. So it's a very strong dependence, okay? Repulsion force, okay? Repulsion force. Okay, so this is sometimes called the Welles formula because this was known on the 40s. Okay, so Victor semicircle law, in what I call the birth of random matrix theory, motivation was the following. A heavy nucleus is a liquid drop composed of many particles with known strong interactions, very strong interactions as the figure show it, okay? Very strong interactions here, okay? So knowing this Welles formula, Wigner said, well, a random matrix will be a possible model for the Hamiltonian of a heavy nucleus. So the question is, which random matrix should be used? Okay, which random matrix? And if we order the eigenvalues of GOE and rescale this matrix by dividing square root of n, and we take the sample spectral distribution, which is a distribution function, random, okay? Empirical distribution function of the eigenvalues. Then the limiting spectral distribution goes to the semicircle distribution on minus two, two. And here is the density of the semicircle distribution, okay? Here is a simulation, okay? That's tells us what's going on. The semicircle distribution is just a semicircle formula divided by one over two pi to have area one. And this is the histogram of the eigenvalues of a simulation of a 1,000 times 1,000 symmetric random matrix, okay? And this is the precise statement, okay? The empirical spectral distribution converges weakly with probability one or weak in probability to the semicircle distribution. Okay. And one has good predictions for moderated dimension n, contrary to the case where everything is independent, like the Glivenko-Cantelli theorem, for example, where everything is independent, all random variables, you have lower rate of convergence. And here, due to the very strong dependence, you have a good predictions for moderated ends, okay? And these papers were published by Wigner in the Annals of Mathematics on the middle of 1950s, okay? So you can also have complex entries, okay? Complex entries. Okay, you take Hermitian with independent Gaussian entries. And when I say independent, is you have to have Hermitian, you have independence above the diagonal and with the diagonal. And in the lower triangle part, you just make the Hermitian part, okay? And you assume normality, okay? You assume normality. Well, here is not a T. I will introduce the T later on, but here are random variables, not processes, okay? And also the distribution of CN is unitary invariant, okay? Well, so the universality of Wigner result is as follows, and that's important because the question was, which random matrix, the eigenvalues of which random matrices we should take to model this high level of atoms, okay? Energy of atoms. Okay, so this is the universality, okay? So we take outside the diagonal, we take independent random variables, also independent of the diagonal random variables. We assume these are independent random variables with this mean, always zero mean, variance outside the diagonal one or any constant, and it doesn't really matter the variance of the diagonal elements, okay? And if we take the empirical spectral distribution and the limit is also semicircle distribution, that's universality, okay? And that's always the basic question of Wigner, okay? Which matrices, what are called Wigner ensembles, okay? Everything is independent, okay? And we can also have similar things for the Hermitian case, not just the symmetric case, okay? And this is important because the joint density of the eigenvalues of a general Wigner ensemble, not Gaussian, is not easy at all, okay? It's not easy at all, okay? That's the one primary result on random matrices. Although random matrices were considered before in 1928 by Bichard and later on by several other people, the dimension, one dimension was fixed n, okay? Okay, so there is another very important result, which is due to Marchenko and Pasteur. And now we take an array, a matrix P by N, on where everything are independent random variables. Here we don't have symmetry, they are not symmetric. It's P times N, okay? And we assume zero mean always, variance one, and four moment condition, finiteness of the four moment, okay? And we consider the sample covariance matrix, okay, and the empirical spectral distribution of this sample covariance matrix. And then whenever P over N goes to C, goes to infinity, okay? When P and N goes to infinity, go to infinity at this rate C, then the empirical spectral distribution converges to what is called the Marchenko-Pasteur distribution. Okay, It doesn't matter really the form of this. I will show you a graph in a moment. But what is important here is that everything of this distribution depends on Z, on this Z, constant Z. Okay? That's what is important. Okay? Here is a case of the simulation of this law when P over N goes to 2/3. That means three times P is more or less equal to 2N. Okay? Okay, that's what is considered the second major important result on convergence of eigenvalues of random matrices. And there are many applications of random matrices in physics, statistics, number theory, biology, etc. But also many, very important in wireless communication. Okay, there are books. I will show some reference at the end. There are books on random matrices and wireless communication, and also wireless random matrices, free probability, and wireless communication. And in one of those books, by Coulette and Deba in the year 2011, at the very end, chapter 19, they mention some perspectives of the subject. And what is said here basically is that the theory or the applications of random matrices in wireless communications have not considered variation on time. Okay, and they said, well, that should be done. Unfortunately, in 1962. This was started by Dyson, Friedman Dyson, who, by the way, died last year. And this is what I would like to explain, what is metric Brownian motion, what is Dyson Brownian motion, and what is the free Brownian motion. That's the first part of my talk. So now we will take an ensemble of matrix random processes, okay? So the matrix for each N will be Hermitian Brownian motion, and we form it with one-dimensional Brownian motions, okay? The real part, the imaginary part are independent, and they will follow this distribution, okay? Which is variance t over 2 in the diagonal and variance 1 outside the diagonal. Okay? And here all these elements are independent above the diagonal. Okay? And let's consider the eigenvalue process of this matrix Brownian motion. Okay? And let's order it. Okay? So a very basic result of Dyson in 1962 says that if we fix dimension, there are two important results. If the eigenvalues start at different positions, they never collide. Okay, they never collide. That means we will have this order if we start with this same order at zero or with probability one, non-colliding property. And the second one is that tells about the dynamics of these eigenvalues. And they follow this stochastic differential equation, Ito stochastic differential equation, where these are one-dimensional independent Brownian motion, and this is a repulsion force, okay? Brownian part plus a repulsion force, okay? That repulsion that was shown in the density also is here, okay? But we have also that they never collide for any t with probability one, okay? And the proof uses classic stochastic calculus and martingale, okay? And Levy a characterization theorem of d-dimensional Brownian motion, okay? So this is basically the idea, okay? The eigenvalues are smooth functions of the entries. Then one can use Itô's formula, okay? And Itô's formula, one needs the second derivative, and the second derivative comes from Hadamard second variation and formula, and that's why this repulsion term appears, okay? That's basically the idea. It's not easy to prove at all. The book by Anderson, Guionet, and Seiduni have a very nice, has a very nice proof, okay? Okay, so now that's about the dynamics, okay? So now take the Dyson spectral measure value processes, okay? And first time I knew about measure value processes was from the talks, several talks of Luis Gorostiza and his co-authors. So let's take the spectral measure value process, the Dyson, okay? And it's rescale, okay? Eigenvalues are rescale. And I use this notation just for the integration of F with respect to a measure, probability measure mu. So one has the uniform Wigner theorem. One has the uniform Wigner theorem that is expressed in this way, okay? And this family of probability measures is the law of what is called the free Brownian motion, that is the semicircle distribution on minus two square raised, minus square of raised of 2t to 2t, square root of 2t, okay? There's a mistake here, okay? No, it's okay. So this is a family of probability measure, and this is what is called the law of the free Brownian motion. And I will explain later on what is the free Brownian motion, okay? But let me make a detour to understand a little bit these dynamics, okay? And the eigenvalue process, Dyson eigenvalue process, okay? So on the late 70s and 80s, stochastic differential equations with both smooth drift and diffusion coefficients are of this form, okay? And they have been considered for many, 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 many years, okay? And the Dyson Brownian motion has non-smooth drift, okay? Non-smooth drift, okay? Here we have smooth drift, here. The drift is not smooth, okay? And let's take the empirical measure value processes of any of these objects, okay? Any of these objects. So for interacting stochastic differential equations, when both drift and diffusion coefficients are smooth, McKee proved that the empirical measure value process converges weakly in probability to mu t, where mu t is the law of a stochastic differential equation, okay, related to alpha and beta, okay. That was proved by McKee, okay. And interacting stochastic differential equations with non-smooth drift coefficients, they arise as we already saw an example with the Dyson Brownian motion, they arise from eigenvalue processes of matricial processes, okay? And many people have considered that, okay? But this limited process, the family, is not the law of a Itô stochastic differential equation. It's the law of free Brownian motion, okay? It's the law of free Brownian motion. So there is a big difference, okay? There is a big difference. There is no diffusion process that is the law that such that WT is law. Okay. So another difference to see the importance of the effect of the impact of the strong interaction of the eigenvalues is the following, okay? When you have interacting stochastic differential equations with a smooth drift and diffusion coefficients, one can show, and this is something that Luis knows well, a limit of fluctuations, okay? Central limit theory for these objects, okay? And it was shown in Hitsuma, by Hitsuda and Mitoma, that Sn converges weakly to a Gaussian process in a nuclear space, okay? And that was one of the reasons that Luis and other people were interested in nuclear spaces, okay? The importance of stochastic process in nuclear spaces, okay? And here are some works that I did with Kalyanpur on this subject, okay? On the other hand, when you have interacting stochastic differential equations where the drift coefficient is not smooth, to have convergence of the process to the law of the free Brownian motion, you need n instead of square root of n, okay? And that's due to the strong dependence of the eigenvalues, okay? And this was done several years ago, the convergence of these fluctuations were studied by Bender, by Israelson, and the result is that you have that this process converges weakly to a Gaussian process in a nuclear space, okay? Also in a nuclear space, but you need N, okay? You need N. Okay. So that gives a little bit understanding of what the Dyson Brownian motion is, and it's a empirical measure value process and its limit, okay? So what is free Brownian motion, okay? And what is the law of free Brownian motion? So let's take some notation. So let's this be the set of probability measures on R, and this be the space of continuous functions from R to this family of probability measures with the topology of uniform convergence, okay? Compact intervals. And also I use this notation, which already mentioned. And let's take the Cauchy transform, okay? This is in general a subject of free probability and non-commutative probability, where the Cauchy transform of a probability measure is very useful instead of the characteristic function or the Fourier transform that is basic in classical probability, okay? And it's defined in this way, and it characterizes the probability measure, okay? So the law of free Brownian motion as a limited measure value process can be expressed in this way, okay? If you have the convergence and time zero, then this family of measure value process, of Dyson measure value process, converges weakly in this space to a unique continuous probability measure that satisfies this integral equation, okay? Measure integral equation. And moreover, this family of measures is this law, okay? Is this law. And this uses the fact that the family of these measures, which we have been called free Brownian motion, the law of free Brownian motion, is characterized by this partial differential equations for the Cauchy transform, kind of Barger equation, okay? And this is basic to the proof and basic to if you want to study more general metrics value processes. Okay, let's see what is the free Brownian motion. I have to talk about a little bit about a free probability. So I go to non-commutative probability space is a unital algebra over the complex with a linear functional such that this linear functional at the unit of A is one, okay? And there are very simple examples of non-commutative non-commutative probability spaces, okay? And elements of A are called non-commutative random variables. This might be a little bit, not fortunately, okay, to mention random variables. They are not random, okay, in the classical case, okay? So examples are the space of D by D matrix with the functional of normalized trace, the space of bounded random variables, where the linear functional is the expectation. Here we have random matrices, okay, with the bounded entries. And the linear functional is expected value of the normalized trace. And algebra of linear operators, you fix a vector U, and then you define the linear function in that way. Okay, there are examples, non-commutative probability spaces, okay? And here the idea is to think of phi as playing the role of expectation in classical probability, okay? And we talk about the moments of A, okay? Phi of A to the K for every K bigger or equal than zero. Or you can talk about joint moments, okay? Of this way, we have an algebra, so everything here stays in the algebra, or every operation here, okay? And the question is when an algebraic distribution is given by an analytic distribution. And you need this kind of generality to generalize this result for classical probability. A random variable R has distribution mu, if and only if the expected value of f of R is the integral of f of k mu dx for every bounded function, measurable bounded, Borel measurable bounded function, okay? In the non-commutative case, you need to go to what is called C star probability spaces when you talk about self-adjoint operators of an algebra with bounded support, or you have to go to W star probability spaces when you go to unbounded operators, okay? C star algebras, W star algebras, von Neumann algebras. That's the kind of generality, but just to have this relation, okay, that relates these moments with this integral, okay? So mu is the analytic distribution of A, okay? And then you go to what is called free independence, okay? A family of subalgebras in a non-commutative probability space is free or freely independent if you have that the linear functional in this product is zero whenever you have expectation. You can think of this as expectation, and for every aj in this subalgebra, you have non-consecutive index. These are not commutative, okay? These are not commutative. So it's very important, no, that you have different algebras here, okay? Subalgebras, okay? And so this is the concept of free independence. If you have two elements which are freely independent with distribution, analytic distribution, mu A1 and mu A2, then the distribution of the sum is the free convolution, okay? There is a measure which is called the free convolution, which is the analytic distribution of these elements, okay? And recall that if A1 and A2 are classically independent, the distribution of the sum is the classical convolution, okay? And where phi is expected value. And of course, there is commutativity, okay? With random variables, one-dimensional random variables, okay? And One way to think about this, one can think of usefulness of the free independence to compute moments, okay? To compute joint moments, a rule to compute joint moments. And that's really the role of classical independence to compute when moments exist, to compute joint moments, okay? So let's think of that, okay? And here is an example of what can be done. I will not give details, but basically you can compute moments, joint moments, okay? Using phi independence, okay? And here we can see that the if A and B are independent, the expected value of this product is of this type and is different of these that would be the case of independence. So free independence and classical independence are different subjects, okay? Okay. One has a central limit theorem for sums of a sequence of independent free random variables with the same distribution and with all moments, with zero mean and variance, this should be one. No, variance t, that's okay, because I need t, okay? Then the distribution of these converges as m goes to infinity to the semicircle distribution. So semicircle distribution appears in Wigner's theorem, but also appears in the central limit theorem in free probability. And that's why the semicircle or Wigner distribution is also called the free Gaussian distribution. And it plays exactly the role of Gaussian, that Gaussian plays in classical probability, is played here in free probability by the semicircle distribution. And the Marchenko-Pastur distribution plays the role of Poisson distribution in classical probability. And that's why the Marchenko-Pastur distribution is also called free Poisson distribution, okay? So one way to understand free probability is the following. And it comes from the block of Terence Tao, okay? Random matrices which are independent in the classical sense, you take two sequences, no, of random matrices that are independent, also tend to be independent in the free probability sense, in the large limit, okay? And because these many computations that are almost impossible in random matrix theory are easy to do using the framework of free probability. So random matrices which are independent, they become freely independent when the dimension goes to infinity, okay? And why is that useful? See, in general, you cannot say too much knowing the eigenvalues of xn and yn, even if they are not random. You cannot say too much about the eigenvalues of the sum of the product. It's not true, at least that they commute, that you have the eigenvalues of the sum is the sum of eigenvalues, okay? However, if xn and yn are asymptotically free, the empirical spectral distribution of the sum of the random matrices can be computed as the free convolution of the empirical spectral distribution of xn and the empirical spectral distribution of yn, okay? And this problem is similar to the computational distribution of the sum of two independent random variables in the classical sense, okay? So that's a way to understand free independence. Okay, so let's talk about now free Brownian motion. What is a free Brownian motion? It's a family of self-adjoint operators, self-adjoint random variables, in a non-commutative probability space, such that at zero is zero, and ST2 minus ST1 has the semicircle law with this parameter, okay? And the increments are freely independent with respect to this linear functional, okay, of the non-commutative probability space. Okay, so that's a free Brownian motion. A family of Sebastian operators with these properties, okay, which is very similar to the case of Brownian motion. Okay, instead of talking about independence, we talk about freely independent. Instead of talking about Gaussian random variables, we talk about semicircle random variables. Okay, and of course, for every t, st has semicircle law of zero mean and variance t. Okay, and one has stochastic calculus for the free Brownian motion, and this has been done by this quote. These are authors here. Okay. A very, very nice work. Bian, for example, is very, very nice work. Okay, so let's talk about semicircular processes. As in classical probability, we talk about Gaussian processes, which means that any linear combination, okay, of a family of random variables is Gaussian. But here, instead of being Gaussian, we will assume that these linear combinations, which are now elements on an algebra, and they are self-adjoint random variables on a non-commutative probability space, okay? Linear combinations have semicircle law, okay, of this type. This is semicircle law with mean m and variance sigma squared, okay? And in particular, the law of a center semicircular process, for that we mean that for each t, p of x t is zero, is uniquely determined by the covariance function. Okay, the covariance function is this. Very similar to what is done in classical probability. Okay, and center semicircular process has stationary increments if you have this condition here. Okay. Okay. And why that? Because then you can talk about non-commutative fractional Brownian motion. We have already seen what is a free Brownian motion, okay? But having that concept of semicircular process, we can talk about non-commutative fractional Brownian motion, and this was done by Nordin and Taku. And for any h, a non-commutative fractional Brownian motion of parameter h is a centered semicircular process in a non-commutative probability space with this covariance function, very similar to what is done when you have classical probability, okay? But now you have semicircular system instead of Gaussian, okay? And you have to go to non-commutative probability space, okay? And for each t, STH has semicircle law of this type, okay? On this interval, okay? And this is the density, okay? And it has stationary increments, okay? Okay, so with that, we started to study the metric fractional Brownian motion and the non-commutative fractional probability stochastic process, okay? So a one-dimensional, I just recall this, a one-dimensional fractional Brownian motion of parameter h, okay, is a zero-mean classical Gaussian process with covariance of this type, okay? Classical, I mean classical probability, okay? It has stationary increments. It is self-similar, okay? And h equal to 1/2 is a one-dimensional Brownian motion, independent increments, okay? And in general, when it's known that for h different 1/2, one cannot use stochastic Itô calculus, but you have to do Skorohod integral, Young stochastic calculus, okay? So now let's consider a matrix of one-dimensional fractional Brownian motions, okay, independent, okay? We consider this matrix and we take it symmetric, okay? We take this one-dimensional fractional Brownian motion, same parameter H, and we take this, what you call symmetric matrix fractional Brownian motion, okay? And then the increments, of course, are not independent, but let's look at the eigenvalues of this new matrix process, okay? Fractional, metric fractional Brownian motion. Okay. So, when H is bigger than 1/2, with David Noalert, we proved that the eigenvalues start at different levels, at different values, then they never collide, as in the classical Dyson Brownian motion. They never collide, okay, with probability one. And also you have the dynamics, okay? You have the dynamics, which is very similar to Dyson Brownian motion, but here, why IT is not fractional Brownian motion, as one could expect it, because in the classical case, in the Brownian case, here you have bigger processes, okay? But here, that's not the case. However, the process is self-similar, okay? It's self-similar. But what is important is that you have a very similar drift coefficient, okay? Non-colliding particles are modeled by these stochastic differential equations. Or this integral here is in the sense of Skorofov, okay? And the proof of this fact, of course, Martingale theory cannot be used as in the Dyson-Brownian motion, and we have to use the Young stochastic integral fractional calculus, okay? And as I said, why I of t is not fractional Brownian motion, but is the law of a self-similar process, okay? For H less than 1/2, it was proven recently by Arturo Jaramillo and David Noalert, the colliding case, okay? The eigenvalues can collide for H less than 1/2. And the kind of tools you use to prove this result is heating probability for Gaussian process and capacity of Gaussian dimension for measurable sets, okay? And it will disappear this year in random metrics theory and applications, okay? So with Juan Carlos Pardo and Jose Luis Perez Garmendia, we consider the empirical spectrum measure value process. So far with what I have said before is just for the dynamics, okay, but not for the empirical measure value process. So we study this convergence and we have this result, okay? We have this result that the measure value process converges to the law of this given by this family, okay? This is the semicircle distribution on this interval, okay? And the family of measure value processes converges to this, that is the law of a non-commutative fractional Brownian motion, okay? Non-commutative fractional Brownian motion, okay? And then we have to prove a result that characterizes the Cauchy transform. We have to, that characterizes that limit, okay? Which is this law of non-commutative fractional Brownian motion. And first we have to show that this family satisfies the Cauchy transform of this family satisfies this partial differential equation, Kainberg's equation, okay? And you can talk about now a fractional Visscher process consider 2m times in n matrices and take the covariance process of those matrices, the eigenvalues. And for H in 1/2 1, you have also the non-colliding property. You can study the dynamics, which was done for H equal to 1/2 by Brew. And again, with Pardo and Jose Luis Perez, we considered the non-colliding stochastic dynamics of eigenvalues for H bigger than 1/2. And we saw that the limiting measurable process is not the free Poisson law, but is something else, but it's very, very much related, okay? I will not give details, okay? But that was done, the Vischer case also, okay? And also we characterize the family of laws, okay? Also in terms of the Cauchy transform. And there have been many works and many in progress by several people on non-commutative process. And this what I said has been based on work with different co-authors and discussions. And there is a very recent work by Jaramillo Pardo and Perez Garmendia, and another work also in progress by Mario Diaz, Arturo Jaramillo and Pardo, and we also have some work in progress for other processes, okay? Non-commutative process and for other matrix value processes, okay? And in particular here, we are considering the case of free Levy processes, and that should connect with the free non-commutative Levy processes. Okay. So here I have some references I have listed. I will send this presentation to Hector. Okay. So several references. But I would like to finish, and if I'm allowed to speak Spanish.
Sí, claro.
Para hablar un poco del impacto del Departamento de Matemáticas de CIMBESTAB en mi formación, en mi carrera y la visión que desarrollé con los años, ¿no? Como estudiante de la Escuela de Física y Matemáticas del Poli, tuve varios profesores de CIMBESTAB, todos dando unos supercursos. Samuel Gisler en álgebra lineal 2, que pensó que era un curso de álgebra moderna 2, y entonces no entendíamos nada en un principio. Enrique Antoniano, un cursazo en teoría de números, con el Pfefferman. Y Dennis Harley, que lo remarco porque fue mi primer profesor en la escuela en un curso de álgebra, y posteriormente... Y posteriormente fue mi director de tesis de licenciatura. Dennis Harley era estudiante de doctorado en topología con Samuel. Conocí a Luis y Onésimo Hernández a través de los libros del Hall por Stone, Luis Gorostiza, que le agradecen, ¿no? El que había dado soluciones a los ejercicios, ¿no? Entonces fue la primera vez que oí hablar a Luis Gorostiza, Y Onésimo Hernández, no sé si Onésimo se acuerda, ¿no? Pero yo fui uno de los revisores de su libro. Como estudiante de estadística, Denis nos puso a revisar el libro de Onésimo de Prioridad y Estadística. Y entonces ahí fue donde conocía, supe de Onésimo, ¿no? Por primera vez. Como estudiante de maestría en la Escuela Superior de Física y Matemáticas, como Luis lo mencionó, ¿no? Tomé el curso de Tomás Bogidesky de Prioridad Avanzada, mi primer curso probabilidad con medida, y yo nunca había llevado medida, más que de la de Beck en RN, ¿ok? Y con Luis Gorostiza comencé un curso, el segundo curso, eran cursos que me valían en la maestría en la Escuela de Física y Matemáticas, pero él comenzó dando el teorema de extensión de Kolmogorov con las notas de Baradán, y para mí era imposible entenderlas, ¿no? Entonces, y mis intereses en esa época estaban más en la estadística. Sin embargo, ahí me quedó la espina grabada, y ahora puedo dar de memoria varias demostraciones de ese teorema. Cuando era estudiante de doctorado, en diciembre de 1984, Enrique Ramírez de Arellano me invitó a desayunar para ofrecerme que regresara a trabajar al Simvestab. Yo terminaba en agosto del 85. Eso es realmente muy, 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 muy importante, ¿no? Cuando uno está terminando un doctorado, que en aquella época, a diferencia de la gente que acaba ahora, no, somos muy naif, ¿no? Y el tener un trabajo asegurado y no tener que ir al job market, ¿no? Etcétera, me permitió terminar mi tesis con mucha tranquilidad y con mucho orgullo, porque además, ¿no? Yo fui a estudiar estadística, mi doctorado es en estadística, pero en aquella época en la Universidad de Carolina del Norte, en Chapel Hill, estaba el Centro de Procesos Estocásticos y era una gran oportunidad trabajar procesos estocásticos, a pesar de que mi formación siempre había sido muy fuerte en estadística. Y ahí llegaban muchos visitantes y era muy agradable, ¿no? Mucho orgullo se sentía, ¿no? Cuando me preguntaban si conocía a Luis Gorostiza. Y yo pues pocas veces decía que no había podido pasar su curso, ¿no? Entonces eso fue muy significativo y eso hizo que estuviese en un paso muy efímero por el Simvestab, solo de 2 semanas, porque también me ofrecieron trabajo en el IMAS y ahí era un ingreso mayor en aquella época, eran muy castigados los salarios del Simvestab. Sin embargo, esas 2 semanas en el en Simvestab, tanto Luis Gorostiza como Onésimo Hernández me enseñaron cómo era la vida académica, ¿sí? Las solicitudes al SNI, las solicitudes de proyectos, etcétera, ¿no? Y eso fue muy importante para mí, ¿no? Y además, pues, continué la relación con ellos, ¿no? Con Luis nunca escribimos cosas juntos, pero sí estudiábamos algunas cosas de espacios nucleares cuando yo regresé de mi doctorado, ¿no? Y Luis era una persona, es una persona, ¿no?, muy conocida en las áreas que yo trabajaba y pues siempre me lo encontraba yo en los congresos y estando de postdoctorado en el Instituto de Matemáticas Aplicadas de la Universidad de Minnesota. Estuve ahí 3 meses y hubo un taller al que Luis fue y expuso un trabajo que, si mal no recuerdo, luego salió en el Annals de Probabilidad. Y fue una velada en casa de Steve Orey, ahí en Minneapolis, donde estaba también Ito y Saúl Bello, un premio Nobel. Y eso fue en 1986, y me acuerdo que ahí Luis se me acercó y me dijo, ¿no? Víctor, deberíamos de organizar un seminario institucional de probabilidad, ¿no? Y que para mí fue primordial. Ahí conocí a María Emilia, conocí a Begoña, conocí a varios colegas, eran estudiantes algunos de Luis Gorostiza, ahí llegaba, ¿no? Boydeski repetía. Mike Marcus venía y daban un seminario, era un espacio todos los viernes en Ciudad Universitaria, nos reuníamos y fue fundamental para mi carrera. Yo no estaba seguro de seguir con procesos estocásticos, eso lo había comentado yo a Luis, ¿no? Quería estudiar estadística, porque siempre mi formación fuerte estuvo ahí. Y ese seminario fue primordial, sobre todo cuando fui a Guanajuato, ¿no? Y bueno, seguí participando, empecé a participar en tesis doctorales con de Onésimo, de Luis, como sinodal. Me invitaban, ¿no? Y pues yo me daba cuenta de cómo eran las cosas, cómo era la organización de congresos, ¿no? Donde Luis Gorostiza fue el organizador principal, ¿no? Del CLAPEN, y también Onésimo invitaba a muchos eventos, organizaba muchos eventos con la gente de la UAM, ¿no? Y yo creo que tanto Luis como Onésimo y también con María Emilia, ¿no? Que está en la conferencia, son muy responsables, ¿no? De que en México se tenga la situación actual de la probabilidad, pero que la probabilidad haya sido reconocida por matemáticos, algo que en el desarrollo de la historia de la probabilidad siempre no se reconocía la probabilidad como una rama de las matemáticas, ¿no? Tardó tiempo, ¿no? Hasta que llegaron los axiomas de Kolmogorov en 1933, ¿no? Yo creo que Luis y Onésimo tienen ese mérito, ¿no? A mí no me hicieron preguntas, Enrique Ramírez de Arellano, no me hicieron preguntas de matemáticas como se hacían algunos otros colegas, ¿no? Entonces yo les deseo muchos años más al Departamento de Matemáticas del Simvestab y les agradezco a Luis y a Onésimo por toda que compartieron conmigo esos 15 días que estuvo en el Simvestab. Es algo que no siempre se sabe, ¿no? Y además ahí inicié una gran amistad con el que era el director Héctor Nava Jaimes. Y muchísimas gracias y muchas felicidades.
Muchas gracias, Víctor. Muchas gracias. Bueno, we have time for questions about anything, the mathematical part and also odds in the staff. Lo que quieran preguntar, por favor.
Bueno, yo no tengo una pregunta. Nada más quiero agradecerle mucho a Víctor por su interesante plática y especialmente por sus comentarios finales con los que voy a dormir muy a gusto.
Sí, muy, muy interesante. ¿Preguntas, comentarios, questions? Yo tengo una preguntita, Víctor. Veo ahí en muchos resultados que ocupan esto de la transformada de Cauchy, ¿no? Que es como el análogo de la función característica en estos espacios conmutativos.
No conmutativos.
No conmutativos, perdón. Y entonces uno puede, o sea, al momento de demostrar las cosas, es la técnica de utilizar esa caracterización de las distribuciones por medio de una transformación. ¿Es similar a lo clásico o de plano cambia mucho?
¿Cómo es similar. Tienes la fórmula de inversión, ¿no? Dado en términos de la parte imaginaria de un límite, ¿no? De la formada de Cauchy. La principal diferencia es que en probabilidad clásica tomas la transformada de Fourier, ¿no? La función característica, y tomas el logaritmo, ¿no? Cuando no es cero. ¿Ok? Es una transformación. Y en el caso de la transformada de Cauchy, el recíproco de la transformada de Cauchy, la inversa cuando existe de ese recíproco, es básico para probabilidad libre, ¿no? De ahí construyes los análogos de lo que serían los logaritmos, ¿no? En otros tipos de probabilidad no conmutativa, ¿no? Como la booleana, toma simplemente el recíproco, ¿no? En otros, monótona, tomas la composición, ¿no? Etcétera, ¿no? Entonces tienes que no es directamente la transformada de Cauchy, ni el logaritmo nada más, no solo una transformación, sino varias cosas más para lograr, ¿cómo se llama? La transformada adecuada, pero parte de la transformada de Cauchy y regresas a la transformada de Cauchy para pues caracterizar la medida, ¿no?
Ok. Sí, pues suena muy, suena interesante y pues elaborado, ¿no? O sea, sí requiere pues mucha, mucha variable compleja, me imagino.
Sí, la herramienta fundamental son funciones analíticas.
Ok.
¿No? La teoría de Nevalina, ¿no? Representación de funciones analíticas, ¿no? En C más, ¿no? Como integrales con respecto a una medida, ¿no?
Ok. De acuerdo. ¿Alguien más tiene preguntas o comentarios? ¿No? Pues aquí hay muchos agradecimientos en el chat. Muchos agradecimientos por los comentarios y las palabras, Víctor. Muchas felicidades y también al Departamento de Matemáticas. Bueno, pues podemos desconectar nuestros, bueno, más bien conectar nuestros micrófonos y darle un fuerte aplauso al profesor Víctor por su interesante charla y sus comentarios. Gracias, Víctor. Bueno, Héctor, te cedo la palabra.
Pues gracias por asistir. Les agradezco mucho a Anton y a Víctor por haber aceptado esta plática en esta celebración. Y pues a todos los que vinieron, a los que tuvieron la amabilidad de conectarse y pues estar acompañándonos en esta celebración. Nada más mañana, les comento que mañana vamos a seguir con las pláticas, solo que la segunda plática no va a ser a las 11:30, como comúnmente se estaba haciendo anteriormente, sino va a ser a las 4. Entonces una va a ser de 10 a 11:30 y la siguiente va a ser de 4 a 5. Sí, así es. Entonces, bueno, ahí en la página del departamento vienen los detalles de las horas y lo mismo, la liga, ¿no? Que va a ser la misma que la de hoy. Y pues nada más, no sé si profesor Luis tenga algo que tenga, quiera decir algo más, profesor Onésimo.
Pues yo nada más quiero felicitar a Víctor por su plática, muy interesante, y me dio mucho gusto saludarte, Víctor. Estás muy bien, ¿eh?
Estoy muy bien, afortunadamente. Afortunadamente estoy muy bien.
¿Se te nota?
Sí. Sin presumo que ya no tomo medicina para diabetes.
Excelente.